You're tuned in to Nerd Overload, your weekly pop and geek culture show covering movies, TV, games, and comics. Now your hosts, Cody Pinnick, Sam Dunham, and Josh Harrison.
Hey everybody, welcome to Nerd Overload, the pop and geek culture show that is putting in its bid to be the new voice of Rick and or Morty. I'm Cody.
I'm Sam.
I'm Josh.
And I'm Samantha.
We have a great show for you this week, as always. Thank you all for tuning in. We're going to be going over a whole bunch of stuff, including some D&D news, some Power Ranger news, and some unfortunate Rick and Morty news. But first, let's talk about some things.
Oh, geez, Rick.
But first, let's talk about some things we have been checking out.
Check it out!
You know, this would have been a perfect time for a Rick and Morty soundboard clip, but I don't have one.
You don't need one.
Don't need one.
It's fine. It's okay. Yeah, it's fine.
Everyone has a Rick and or Morty impression.
I'm Mr. Meeseeks. Look at me.
Oh, boy.
Even though you sounded like more like Mr. PB there.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I forget what
it is. Ooh-wee, Rick.
Ooh-wee.
Ooh-wee. Yeah, anyway, this is... Yeah, this is
devolving into madness, and let's get it back on
course.
Let's
get back on track. Let's talk about some things we have been doing this week. Who would like to start?
I mean, I got a couple, I guess.
Let's hear it.
So I continue to watch Velma.
No, we told you
Josh,
to stop.
Bad. Josh.
Bad job.
We need to have an intervention.
I don't know.
You're hurting yourself and those around you.
There's a lot of Hanna-Barbera references in the last episode.
I'm sure there are,
but doesn't make it a good show.
I never said it was good, but it is reaching a story climax very soon.
Well, I'm glad that they managed to have the basic elements of a story, then it sounds like.
Yeah.
I mean, the last couple episodes have been a little, I don't know, not as absolutely terrible.
Yeah, you can't say better.
Yeah. I mean, the horrible violence is kind of toned down a little bit. Velma does seem to be having some kind of character development.
Is it making her less insufferable?
Not quite yet. Oh. But anyway, they do say the word Scooby.
Huh. Okay.
Apparently, there's some group that got started, and the acronym was S-C-O-O-B-I. Scooby?
Well, that also seems like the easiest, the lowest hanging fruit.
Oh, yeah. Oh, and then they found a piece of paper there with the word Jinkies written on it.
Okay,
and she finds it, and she goes, Jinkies? And like, what is that?
That's the worst kind of joke.
I know.
Here's this old thing that the character is known for. We're going to poke fun at it.
Pretty much.
In Spider-Man No Way Home, they do that with Dr. Octopus when he's trapped, and they like make fun of how stupid his name sounds.
Yep.
Don't do that.
What else are you going to call a guy that has octopus arms coming out of his back?
Captain Squid?
Dr. Extra Arms Man. The Squiddler.
Dr. Inflatable Flailing Arms Man.
There are names to poke fun at in comics, but I don't think that was
one. I don't think that's one. Yeah.
Not that bad of one.
That's kind of iconic.
Yeah.
Matter Eater Lad.
Yeah, that one's funny. Yeah.
That one's funny. Yeah, but like not. Anyway.
Yeah. Yeah.
Kite Man. Now there's a name.
Hell yeah.
I heard
two people will get that joke.
Unless you've watched, Harley Quinn.
Yeah.
He's a major player in Harley Quinn.
It's getting a Valentine's special.
It is.
Here coming up.
Yep.
A much better HBO animated series.
Yeah, yes. Speaking of HBO animated series, we'll just watch Harley Quinn instead of Velma.
But also speaking of HBO animated series, watch the first couple episodes of the new season of YOLO the Crystal Adventure, or whatever it's called.
Why do you do this to yourself?
Gosh. You okay, bud?
I don't know.
Blink twice if you need assistance.
Have you watched Smiling Friends?
No.
Watch that. That's a good one. That's a good one. Watch that one.
Plus, it has some of the Red Letter Media guys. That first episode, Mike Stoklasa is the main guy they help.
But also, I don't like the Red Letter Media guys. You do.
Yeah, well, that's fair. That's fair and true.
I don't know. It's still that weird, super goofy, ugly art. Yeah. It's an ugly show.
It's an ugly show, but it's supposed to be ugly.
I mean, but also, I mean, that's the one thing. It's like, Velma is animated well.
Velma's gorgeous, unfortunately.
Yeah, it's a very yeah. well-animated show.
I feel so bad for the artists.
Oh,
they
yeah.
definitely were putting in the work.
Mm-hmm. To also, be let down also, by the writers this, also, well, this badly.
Weird Al is the voice of one of the band kids.
Sure.
Which is also unfortunate.
Sure, why not?
I don't understand why the cop character, they drew him to look like Don Knotts, but he doesn't sound like Don Knotts.
Oh, the sheriff?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's just...
Yeah, that seems like a swing and a miss.
Yeah, it's, you know, that one voice that... He does a lot of... He's done a lot of stuff, and it's the same voice in everything. He always plays the same type of character.
What other character has he done? I bet I can spot him.
Oh, let me...
While you're looking that up, I'm just going to say, if you have a Don Knotts character, just like a Rick and a Morty, everyone has a Don Knotts.
No, I couldn't do a Don Knotts if I tried.
Oh, gosh, Scooby and Shaggy!
So that was pretty good.
I don't know. Your Don Knotts still kind of sounded like a...
It's all variations on the King of Town. I know. It's okay.
No! That's my King of Town.
It's a good King of Town.
He's Milton in Office Space.
That's right, yeah.
Oh, Stephen Root.
Yeah, Stephen Root.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bill.
Yeah,
Bill Dotrieve.
Yeah, Bill Dotrieve.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's who the sheriff is. Chief Kohlberg.
Okay.
Cogburn. Oh, yeah, he's also the farmer in Bee and Puppycat. I forgot about that.
Yes, yep.
Stephen Root is a good voice, a good actor.
He's a good actor,
well.
just
all around.
I actually really like him in Dodgeball. Have you ever seen Dodgeball? Yeah. Yeah, he's great in that.
He was in True Blood.
Really?
Yeah. He's like a victim in a basement for several episodes, I think. At least a couple.
Huh. Really? That's wild.
Oh, he's also Cringer in the Masters of the Universe Revelation.
That's really good casting.
Yeah, that's actually excellent casting.
I kind of forgot about that.
Yeah. God, welcome to Rootcast.
Yeah, I know. He has done so much. He's done a lot.
Welcome to the field, the Stephen Root.
I can't stop playing Persona 3 Portable. That just got the re-release on Xbox and Switch.
Oh, okay.
It's so good. It's such a good game. All the Persona games are so good. I would put them in like a top 5 of the best game franchises.
But you better not stream it.
Not certain parts.
They
don't want spoilers.
Right. Which is... How do you stream playing a game and not spoil things?
Also, the game's like 10, 15 years old at this point.
Well, it's because the people at Atlas are a bunch of old dinosaurs that don't understand how media works these days. But whatever.
Everything's so streamlined, too, because it's the portable version. So you don't do a lot of walking around except when you're in the dungeons. The rest of it's like kind of has a visual novel setup to it.
Yeah.
So it doesn't waste a lot of your time traveling between different areas. You're just making your selections off the menu and pointing and clicking on stuff on the screens. And then when you're bored with that, then you go in the dungeon and it's an RPG and it's 3D. And the social links are so good and fun to develop. And the little stories that you get out of every character as you develop the social links are very good. You get both a robot and a dog on your team.
Well, then perfect. Sold.
You know, they could have cut their losses and made a robot dog.
No, they're both two independent characters, and they're both great. She's got gun fingers.
Nice, nice.
It's weird for a robot dog to have fingers.
I was going to say, it's weird for a dog to have gun fingers.
No, the robot girl has gun fingers.
Right.
The dog carries like a kunai in his mouth.
Oh, no, that's adorable.
Is it a Shiba?
Might be like some kind of Akita, I think.
Mm.
Okay.
So a similar breed.
Yeah.
Well, I've been going back and watching a bunch of really old, obscure cartoons from like the late 80s, early 90s.
That's some of the best stuff.
It is. Well, not what I've been watching.
Well, yeah. I mean, not best as in like actually good, but best as in like cringe watching, hate watching kind of stuff.
Do you remember?
Oh, no. Cartoons were always better back in the day, you guys. They've only been crap.
Oh, you mean like RoboCop, the animated series?
Oh, it's so bad.
All 12 episodes of it?
The art's so much better. It's not the CalArts style.
Or Rambo, The Force of Freedom. It had 65 episodes.
Did it?
That's too many.
It had 65 full episodes.
That's too many.
Yeah.
What about Chuck Norris Karate Commandos? Say, only Chuck got like six.
Five.
Like, five.
Because I also watched Chuck Norris Karate Commandos. Yeah, they're so cringeworthy, and I mean, it's so formulaic, and it's very clear that it's just there to sell a toy, but whatever.
One of the first animated things I ever did of my own characters was like a parody of the opening of Chuck Norris Karate Commandos.
Nice, nice.
And I've lost it to time, and I wish I could I wish I could just have that clip back.
Oh, that's great.
What was up with cartoons back in the day, like, or companies back in the day making animated shows for
of
kids?
Like R-rated
toys.
Movies.
Yeah.
They want to sell toys.
RoboCop.
That's all it is.
Toxic Avengers.
The Toxic Crusaders is great, and I will not stand for that slander.
There was always, like, Terminator toys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Beetlejuice.
Swamp Thing had a bunch of toys, and I wouldn't
Swamp
make a kid
Thing
watch
had,
the Swamp Thing
Swamp
movie.
Thing, I had all the Swamp Thing toys when I was a kid. There's a story in which, as a child, I had the color-changing Swamp Thing. You would pour cold water on him, and he would go from green to brown because he's like disguising himself as a tree.
Because those are the two colors of Swamp Thing.
Those are the two colors of Swamp Thing. So I thought, okay, what would happen if I get him so cold? What would happen? So I buried him in the snow and promptly forgot where he was for the entire winter when I was a kid. This was one of those years that we got a ton of snow. So in the spring, my dad was coming home, coming inside the house, and he just finds a Swamp Thing that is turned so brown it has rolled to purple.
Whoa!
Yeah, and he never color changed again. He was permanently stuck in the extreme.
It's because he was dead.
It's because I killed Swamp Thing.
He turned purple from the hypothermia.
He was in the snow for a solid 3 months.
You gave Swamp Thing frostbite. Third-degree frostbite.
I am Swamp Thing's biggest villain, arch nemesis, is what we're finding
Swamp
out.
Swamp Thing became a Wendigo.
He did. But yes.
But Swamp Thing 2, I think it's child abuse if you make a kid watch Swamp Thing 2.
Well, that's true. That's true. The Swamp Thing cartoon only had 5 episodes, and it was fine. It was fine. But yeah, I've been on a real kick of weird old obscure stuff. One, my white whale right now is the Wacky Misadventures of Ed Grimsley.
Ed Grimley.
Grimley. Ed Grimley. That's it.
I
always mispronounce that.
I really liked that show when I was a little kid, apparently.
I too enjoyed that show, I must say.
Was it Martin Short?
Martin Short.
Yeah.
Yep. It was Martin Short. It was originally an SCTV sketch that turned into a show. And there were a lot of SCTV people that guest voiced on the animated series. And I know it's out there, and I just haven't been able to find it.
Huh.
But that is my white whale right now.
Do you guys remember, like, this is just other older cartoons, but like the adventures or the misadventures of Tex Avery, and it had nothing to do with like
the actual
Tex Avery.
Yeah, he was kinda. Like a cowboy.
Yeah.
I vaguely remember.
Yeah,
that. Yeah,
it was so stupid.
Hey, you guys remember Super Dave?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, Super Dave is great.
Super Dave and
Eek the Cat.
Eek the Cat. Dave the Barbarian.
Dave the Barbarian, yeah, that's a good one.
Oh, man. With that stupid
it's
talking sword.
Time somebody's brought up Dave the Barbarian in the past 4 days, I think.
I don't know.
Oh, wow.
I don't know. It just randomly kind of sometimes pops up in my head.
Oh, yeah. I'll be sitting at work with nothing going on, and my brain will just go, hey, remember this?
Yeah.
Hey, you should be paying attention, but do you remember Super Dave? I wonder if Super Dave still exists somewhere in the ether.
Cowboys of Moo Mesa.
The Cowboys of Moo Mesa. Yeah.
Brave Star.
That's good stuff.
Brave Star is always my like.
Brave Star
is my weird one that a lot of people don't ever remember, or they think I'm lying when I talk about it.
Travis McElroy has been on a big Cowboys of Moo Mesa kick lately.
Nice.
On their show. Which actually, what is it? Cowboys Code of the West Boys of Moo Mesa is technically the entire title of the show.
Oh, wow.
Cow is an acronym for Code of the West.
Uh-huh. Oh, man.
Hey, remember that really bad He-Man spinoff that took He-Man to space?
The New Adventures of He-Man?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have all of it.
Ooh, that's bad.
It was 3 seasons long.
What?
I mean, they were half seasons. They were 13 episode seasons. No. They were 20 episode seasons because it equaled 65 episodes total.
It's so weird how they would order such big orders of shows back in the day.
That didn't make no sense. Garbage.
It's like the Addams Family. Like, there's one season, but it's like 80 episodes.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
I mean, the first season of Steven Universe is like 65.
Most first seasons of animation is 65, and then they drop it down to 13 episode orders.
And it took the most of that first season for the story to ever really get to going.
Well, they had to do the regular episodic ones to
get people rolled in.
Yeah. Okay, so we have the real Ghostbusters, and then we have the Ghostbusters. Do you remember those two animated series?
The Ghostbusters has the gorilla.
The Ghostbusters has the gorilla.
Yep.
Yes.
The real Ghostbusters has Egon with a pompadour.
Yellow with a golden pompadour?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. What about Extreme Ghostbusters? Do you guys remember Extreme Ghostbusters?
That's the one with the goth girl and...
So one with the goth girl and the guy in the wheelchair.
Yeah.
I remember that one.
I remember when the new Ghostbusters movie was about to come out and I was getting amped up on Ghostbusters.
Uh-huh.
I watched a couple of a couple episodes of Extreme Ghostbusters. It wasn't bad.
It was fine.
I mean, that was kind of like when I was on my Godzilla kick back in, like, what, 2014?
Speaking of which, the Godzilla...
cartoon?
Which one?
The one with Godzuki.
The one with Godzuki.
The one from, like, the Godzilla 2001.
Godzilla 2001, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, okay, so at the same time, like, bringing up Godzilla, like, the Matthew Broderick, you know, lizard garbage one.
Nick Papadopoulos? Yeah. That's his character's name.
Yeah. Everyone pronounces it wrong. That's the whole gag.
Low-hanging fruit jokes. Anyway.
But Big Guy and Rusty. I loved that show.
Big Guy and Rusty was pretty good.
I loved that show.
Mega's XLR.
with the hot rod for a mecha robot head.
Two idiots who own a junkyard find a broken robot
and put a muscle car
on its head and
drive it with like a PlayStation controller.
Yes.
I've never watched it, but I've only heard good things about
it. It's actually pretty good.
I mean,
XLR is pretty decent.
There was that, and there was Symbiotic
Titan.
Yeah.
I've heard nothing but good things about that. I watched the
second series in the Del Toro like animated Troll Hunter thing. Mm-hmm. The Five Below or whatever they called it.
Yeah.
I read a lot of people say it had mirrored a lot of Symbiotic Titan.
Really?
Like in its story elements.
Interesting. Gosh, what are some other good ones? I just had one on the top of my head, but I can't think of it now.
Was it really old, or was it late 90s, early 2000s? I guess that really is old now.
Pirates of Darkwater?
I loved that show when I was a kid. I loved Pirates of Darkwater.
I think when Mega's XLR was on, I thought I was too cool to watch that show. I thought I was like, well, they're trying to be an anime, and I watch real animes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that is a very prevalent thought from that time. Yeah, yeah.
That sounds about right.
Uh-huh.
When we were edgy teens.
I read Inuyasha manga in study hall, so I don't need this.
Fukawari.
Oh, gosh.
Sit, boy.
That's what that means. Last one. Do you remember that weird Spider-Man parallel universe one?
Spider-Man Unlimited?
Unlimited, yeah.
It wasn't a parallel universe. He went to another planet.
Yeah, right. Other planet. That's
he went
right.
to another
because,
planet.
Because John Jameson was there.
Yeah.
As a freedom fighter.
Was he?
Yes.
Because I remember him going... Because I remember the whole episode opens up in regular animated Spider-Man. He gets on the rocket, goes to the other planet. And because they didn't have the rights to the suit, he got a whole new suit.
And Venom and Carnage went. But he went with him. But also they... became like weird slop monsters.
How do you get the rights to make a Spider-Man ship but don't get the rights to a suit? How does that happen?
I don't know, but they sure figured that out.
But also, almost everybody in the show was like a weird animal hybrid. It was like furry Spider-Man.
One of his main villains was the High Evolutionary.
Yeah. Something along those lines. Or they were trying to eat the High Evolutionary's lunch.
I just remember that suit from Spider-Man Unlimited was one of the unlockables in the PlayStation 1 Spider-Man game.
Yes.
I love that.
That is such a good game.
That's a great game.
Oh, yeah. I played that I had the N64 version, so it was the inferior.
Yeah.
But it was still playable and fun.
I wasn't a huge comic book guy. I didn't even know anything about Spider-Man, but I was interested because Neversoft made it and they made Tony Hawk. And I was real into Tony Hawk. I remember, I loved it.
I remember unlocking Spider-Man in Tony Hawk and doing those quick moves where you kick the board out and then web sling it back.
Yep.
Oh, man. Those were the times, man, when everything smelled like Doritos and Mountain Dew.
Oh, man. Good stuff.
Playing GoldenEye with your buds.
Oh, uh-huh. Speaking of GoldenEye, I did play the port of that came out today.
Oh, cool.
It came out on Xbox and it came out on Switch online, whatever.
And 64 expansion pack.
Yeah. I played it on the Xbox because it
has... Game Pass.
Yeah. And it has the better controls. Apparently, you can't map the right stick to look around in the Switch version.
Huh, weird.
You're stuck with, the original control scheme. It's a very Nintendo move.
Yeah.
I heard in the Switch 64 version, there's a control scheme called Solitaire, which is a little more closer to modern style.
Something like that.
There's probably some way you can... I think there was a control scheme in the original game that had you use two controllers.
You could do that.
You could probably finagle that somehow.
Yeah.
But you shouldn't have to.
This is true.
But Nintendo, so...
But isn't Rare... Or isn't either Rare or Microsoft putting out a remaster of GoldenEye?
I thought that was the talk. They had talked about it. They had made it. And it had leaked...
And then they decided not
to. And then it didn't actually have... They couldn't get the rights.
There's actually a full episode of What Happened from Matt McMuscles on YouTube about it.
Oh, okay.
Really interesting stuff.
Okay.
That's also a recommend. The Matt McMuscles series on YouTube, What Happened. There's about... I mean, they're 20 minutes long, and there's about 50 or so of them. And history of video games and stuff. I watch
them as they come out every Saturday. I'm like, oh, it's Matt McMuscles time.
Yep. It's like... history of video games, history of some movies. They did the WCW Wrestling Federation as an entire episode. They talk about the travesty that is Shenmue 3.
Yeah. Shenmue is a series, period.
Yeah.
Started off so strong where you're looking for sailors and your dad's murderer. And then
looking for sailors.
And then somehow you make it to China, play a bunch of palinko, and...
drive a forklift.
No, that's the first one.
But the GoldenEye port.
Yes.
It's GoldenEye. They didn't do anything. They upped the resolution. That's it.
Oh, and gave it widescreen.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
And when you pause, it goes out of widescreen and it's kind of weird. But it still plays good. I still think it's a fun game.
Cool.
The trailer kind of made me laugh a little bit because the very end, they just throw the proximity mine on the thing. That was my favorite weapon to do in multiplayer because I would just line hallways with it.
I love how they put him in put the proximity line in Smash too.
Yeah, that's great.
Those games were so bad.
Good times. Good times.
But and it runs at 30 frames. It's locked at 30 frames per 30. Second.
Oh,
but
that's not bad.
It's a Nintendo 64 game. They're all locked at...
Unless you're Kirby.
You're lucky if it's 30 frames per second.
Unless it's Kirby 64, which is 60, somehow.
Oh, Sakurai wouldn't let it be any other way.
Oh, that's true. It is. It's his baby. You know, that is one of the few games that is still difficult to emulate on PC. Not that I would ever have emulated something.
Oh, no, never, PC, ever, 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 no.
But it's on Switch Online now.
It's on Switch Online. Yeah, you can play it now. All right, hey, we have actually hit time, so let's go ahead and go to break. And when we come back, we'll get into some news.
Hello, I'm Ben Vaughn, the host of The Many Moods of Ben Vaughn. Heard every Saturday night at 8 p.m. here on WZMO 104.7 FM. We span many decades, many styles, and many moods on my show. So tune in to The Many Moods of Ben Vaughn every Saturday night at 8 p.m. See you then.
Hey, Paigey. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
I don't know, Paige. But I do know this. Long Play is the number one show at both 11 p.m. Fridays and 3 p.m. Saturdays, right here on, you guessed it, 104.7 WZMO. I invite you to tune in and check out the show that's a legend in its own mind.
All right, guys, we are back from the break. I hope you enjoyed the promos for some fine shows here on WZMO. And now let's get into some news.
Do the Mario! Swing your arms from side to side. Come on, it's time to go! Do the Mario!
Do the Mario!
The instructions for doing the Mario are the same as walking.
It is, yes. That's very true. I hope that they work that into the movie somewhere.
I feel like they will. I think it's very likely. They're taking so much from like
the various old
mythos.
Yes.
The old lore.
Yes. If only Captain Lou were here with us to do a cameo.
Yeah.
Although, what if they get Danny? Oh, what
he's,
is his name?
No, he's dead too.
Oh, really? He passed
Danny,
away
yeah,
too?
Yeah, Danny
oh,
Wells.
Danny
passed
Wells
away
passed
also.
Away. Oh,
Mario
bummer.
And Luigi are both dead.
Canonically.
R.I.P.
And Bob Hoskins.
Yeah.
Wow. All right, let's go ahead and talk about some things to start things off. You want to talk about that D&D trailer?
Sure.
We did just watch it.
There's a brand new trailer for the D&D Honor Among Thieves movie. And it gives a little bit more of an idea of what the movie's about. Kind of general plot. And Josh, you recognized the setting.
Yes, because they mentioned the Red Wizards. And the Red Wizards of Thay are some big villain players in the Forgotten Realms setting of Dungeons and Dragons, which is not surprising because it's one of their bigger, more popular. That's where a lot of their big characters come from.
Gotcha. Yeah.
Like Driss Duerden and the other Icewind Dale players. And
yeah. Cause I figured it was going to be either that or the one that's half, was it Ravnica? That's half
magic and
the Gathering.
Half D&D. Ravnica is the world that Dungeons and Dragons or not, the Magic the Gathering does set place.
Right. And the third one is Eberron. Is that a thing?
Eberron. Yep. Eberron is another campaign setting world, but then there you also have Dragonlance. And...
Oh, yeah, Dragonglass. That had a whole bunch of like novels and stuff. With,
oh,
right?
Yeah. That was actually the whole thing. Margaret Wise and they wrote the Dragonlance books a long time ago because it was based off a Dungeons & Dragons campaign they were playing.
Right. So it was Critical Role before Critical Role.
Yeah, so yeah. I was about to say, so it's Critical Role before Critical Role.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
So what kind of things should we expect because this is set in Forgotten Realms? What can you extrapolate from the setting and what we saw in the trailer?
Well,
other than zombies and dragons.
Well, Forgotten Realms is, I mean, it's pretty standard D&D stuff. The big changes are like locations. They might name drop characters or something or places.
Okay.
Like,
is this where Drizzt is from?
Yep. Okay. Drizzt Duerden. Elementor, the Grand Wizard, and places like Neverwinter.
Oh, Neverwinter. Okay, sure.
Neverwinter, Icewind Dale, Baldur's Gate.
I only recognize those as video games.
Yeah,
well, yeah,
a lot of these
yeah,
sound like video
yeah,
games.
Because they are. They
yeah.
were.
So Forgotten Realms is kind of like the vanilla setting.
Technically, Greyhawk is the vanilla setting. That's the standard D&D. Gary Gygax's original world.
Gotcha.
Forgotten Realms is where most of the novels are take place.
Right. Well, that's why I know Drizzt, because there's like a million books with him.
Yep. R.A. Salvatore wrote a lot of those. And, I mean, I really like him, too. I mean, Drizzt is a bit overdone, but he's fun.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the Dark Alliance games were really good.
Oh, yeah,
you
know, those were fun.
Yeah.
I still haven't played the remake? Remaster?
It's a cheap remaster.
So this movie looks pretty fun. I mean, they hit a lot of the high notes. There are zombies.
Yep.
There's an owlbear.
Yep.
That someone turns into.
Gelatinous cube.
There's a little gelatinous cube.
A mimic.
Yeah. A big fat dragon.
A big, chunky
red dragon.
Yep, yep.
And then turning a statue of I think it was a copper dragon into a living, it was definitely the living stone spell or whatever it is.
Gotcha.
I noticed a couple, like the one wizard uses I think Mage Hand or something to like block an attack or something.
We had a character who accidentally set a trap because he failed his investigation roll. Yeah, essentially.
Yeah, he accidentally tripped the button that activated a trap.
That scene right there got me thinking more like, yeah, they're going to do a post-credit sequence, and it's been a bunch of kids playing
D&D.
Yeah,
it's just a bunch of normal people playing D&D.
Yeah.
I mean, that would be the best. I mean, if they Lego movie, that would be the best thing they could do.
It really is. Yeah.
Like, instead of trying to make it like a serious fantasy film, like kind of like what the original Dungeons & Dragons movie tried to do, even though it was really, 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 really bad.
Sure. It's a lot of reallys.
Yeah, oh, so there's some more reallys in there.
Yeah.
The movie is absolute garbage.
Oh, absolutely it is. You know what? I would be fine with it being a bunch of kids playing D&D or a bunch of people playing D&D in the real world. I don't want it to be the people getting sucked into the game like your anime isekai or your...
Or the original cartoon series.
The original Dungeons & Dragons cartoon.
Or I was going to say like the Jumanji sequels.
Yes,
where
the
you
Jumanji.
Get sucked into the game and become characters in the game. I don't want that.
They got sucked into the world of Dungeons & Dragons through a roller coaster.
That's right.
Reason,
the original
that's
cartoon.
That's the plot to the original cartoon.
Yes. Wow. And they all had different stats or different classes like the acrobat.
Well, because those were old second edition classes.
Those were AD&Ds.
Yep. The acrobat, the cavalier. Those were old.
Right.
AD&D, Advanced Dungeons and Dragons, second edition, you know, stuff.
Yeah.
Because that's what it was back in the day. It took second edition was a long.
I
period.
Started a video on like the history of D&D, and yeah, it's like. AD&D was it for the longest time.
I own books from every edition except for 4th, because that is where I draw the line.
No, that sounds about right, because 4th was not especially good.
4th was them trying to make an MMO in a tabletop.
Although it is funny, the first D&D podcast I ever listened to was Critical Hit for the Major Spoilers, the site I used to write reviews for.
Yeah.
And their setting was 4th. So that was kind of my first real huge big intro into D&D was listening to these guys, most of them who hadn't played before, figuring out 4th edition. And yeah, it just seemed more... Something wasn't right with it.
5th is definitely easier to get people not meshed into the already in D&D to like learn it. Definitely has a much more... gentle learning curve.
Gotcha.
And D&D Beyond is such an incredible tool for that too.
Sure.
It makes it so much easier to like roll a character. You can do it in 5 minutes.
Sure. Yeah.
Versus doing it like in 3 or 3.5, where it literally takes you an hour if you're good.
Right. Or especially Pathfinder, where it takes you an entire session to build your character.
Well, yeah, because Pathfinder was built off the bones of 3.5.
It's 3.5 for crazy people.
Yeah.
When I was DMing my first game, they convinced an NPC to join them, which was not something I had planned.
No.
But they rolled good enough to where it's like, well, I guess it probably should happen. And I was able to...
I guess I should make a voice for this guy.
Yeah, so I just rolled the guy up in 2 minutes on D&D Beyond.
Oh, see, that's cool.
And then they had... And it kind of worked out because none of them picked like a sword guy. You know, wasn't a tank in the group.
Yeah.
So like they had their tank now.
That's cool.
I never understand groups that don't, I don't know, try to fill necessary roles.
It was like for a one shot. It wasn't a serious game. It was my first one.
That's like back, like, you know, when I used to play pretty regularly, I'd always get thrown into being the cleric because we'd never have a
no
healer.
No one had a cleric, yeah.
Yeah, no one wanted to play cleric, and I'm like, well, guess it's me.
Well, that's why my barbarian took a thing of bard so he can get healing word. So, because we needed someone who could do that.
Or a DM's just nice, like, oh, you also find a whole bunch of healing potions.
That is also what they ended up doing, yeah.
Anyway,
speaking
anyway,
of
the movie.
we're actually pretty much done talking about the movie, but there is more D&D news. We might as well get this out of the way as well. A few weeks ago, we talked about the open gaming license.
Yeah,
that
Wizards was trying to push,
basically trying to say, hey, everything you make, you made this. We made this.
The open gaming license sounds like something you'd have to pay the state to be able to have a slot machine in your business.
Yeah.
That's very true. But just today, we're recording this on Friday, just today, Wizards and Hasbro basically said, hey, we're not going to go through with all that. We're not going to change things.
Hey, look at that. The internet bullied another big company into something.
Well, you know what it was? People started unsubscribing from D&D Beyond.
Yep.
And you know what?
Money talks.
Vote with your dollar.
Yeah.
That's true.
Exactly.
That's what we always say.
Vote with your dollar. So good on them. Good on you guys.
Yeah.
We did it.
Yeah.
You guys rolled a nat 20 on that one. Ba-dum-bum.
But here's the thing. Was it an intimidation check?
I think so.
I think... Yeah, either intimidation or persuasion with advantage.
Yeah.
You're sitting there talking to him, and the barbarian's standing behind you and giving you an addition.
That's it. All right. Yeah, there's really not much else to go over.
Yeah, basically they said, okay, our bad.
Yeah.
You can make whatever you want.
Mea culpa, do what you want. And I'll tell you what it probably was. It was probably Critical Role saying, okay, well, for our next season, we're going to look at Pathfinder
Savage Worlds.
Or Savage Worlds or something, yeah.
Oh, man, I like Savage Worlds. There's a lot of good stuff. They have that really, that Weird West setting, Deadlands, which is really good.
I kind of like the idea of playing weird fantasy Western.
Yeah, I'd like, do a Weird West campaign.
Cowboys with magic? That sounds kind of rad.
Deadlands is definitely the best.
Yeah.
I do that.
Like reading the history of like the Deadlands like universe or like world setting is so fun, so weird because it has everything you could ever want. Like you've got guns, but you've also got zombies and demons and this, that, and the other.
I could do a weird Southern accent the whole time.
It would be in universe.
It would be in universe. Yeah. All right. So switching gears, I want to touch on one thing real quick before we get to the next big topic. And guys, guess what? It's Sam's Power Ranger Minute. And I swear it's only going to be like a minute.
I always love how you don't ever like you don't go for like the cool Power Rangers theme. You use
it's the bulk and
the
skull,
bulk and skull
because
goof.
it's the best theme. It's literally one of the best themes in the show.
I mean,
and they use it forever.
I know, and it is just as iconic as the dun, 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 dun.
Oh, I mean, listen, who am I more like? Am I more like a Power Ranger or am I like Bulk and Skull? Let's be honest.
You're not a tool.
Well, neither were they.
Or an idiot.
They became good people eventually.
They were the
plucky comic relief, and it's all good. Anyway, going to touch on this real quick. Power Rangers is hitting its 30th season.
Oh, my
30
bones.
Years
my bones.
Of Power Rangers.
My bones.
And they are doing a new one-off special. They're going full Netflix. There's no actual station that's like TV station that's going to be playing. It's all Netflix. And they're doing a special one-shot episode called Mighty Morphin Power Rangers Once and Always. It is going to be...
There is no escape.
There is zero escape from the Power Rangers. It is somewhere...
That's the big announcement is the Taupe Ranger is going to show up.
That's it, yes. Okay, it looks like... right. So it looks like the Power Rangers, this special is going to be... is going to be aired sometime in early 2023. So sometime in the next couple months, we're going to be getting this. They've been filming over in New Zealand.
Where they do,
because it's cheap over there.
New Zealand's beautiful country.
It's cheap and beautiful, and they can get actors for cheap. But they're bringing back a lot of the original cast. You're getting your Walter Jones. That's
The Black Ranger.
You're getting...
David Yost.
David Yost is actually directing it.
Yep, he is like the head of
the
project.
Because that's what he did after he left Power Rangers. He basically became a director. You're getting...
And an activist.
And a good LGBTQ+ activist. We are getting Catherine Sutherland, the second Pink Ranger.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the Australian one.
Yeah.
Again, because Amy Jo Johnson went on to have a...
actual career?
A real career. I was going to try to not be mean, but she went on to have a real career.
A lot of Power Ranger actors really don't grow much beyond.
Very rarely. I mean, you get like a Rose McIver who does
stuff.
Who's
on hit television show Ghosts, which is fun.
It's a great show, yeah. And Amy Jo Johnson was one of those that had a pretty decent career afterwards. But we're getting Adam Park, that character Adam Park, played by Johnny Young Bosch.
Yep.
He's going to be in it. The second Black Ranger.
Vash the Stampede.
Yes.
Also the voice of Vash the Stampede. Mm-hmm. Very accomplished voice actor, Johnny Young Bosch.
Yes. It also has Steven Cardenas.
Yep.
As Rocky, the best and worst Red Ranger.
Also, isn't he a local boy?
He's not local, but he does a lot of conventions and stuff. Mm. He did something kind of local here, but no, Rocky is, he was super bland until later on in the series when they decided, you know what, we're going to play him as dumb. He's the dumb one.
Oh man, Richard Horvitz is coming back as Alpha 5.
Richard Horvitz
Invader
is Alpha
Zim
5.
Invader Zim is coming back.
Barbara Goodson is going to be voicing
Rita Repulsa.
Rita Repulsa. So we're getting a Rita again.
Oh, Karen Ashley's showing up too.
Yep. Karen Ashley.
You should email her about your money.
That criminal who owes me $20 or a movie.
Aisha, where's my money?
Alleged criminal.
Alleged criminal.
Alleged crowdfunding monster, Karen Ashley. And this is coinciding with the 30th season of actual Power Rangers, where they revealed the suits, the actors in the suits, and I don't like them.
Mm.
I don't like them. They
squarely in the Iron Mouth camp on this one.
I bet. Have you guys seen the suits?
Yeah, they're bad.
They're bad. There's nothing on the front. See, they look like kind of like they have the shoulder pads, kind of like the original Green Ranger, and they have these weird gloves and boots and stuff.
Solid color morph suits.
Yeah, basically the male actors have fake abs underneath them.
Oh,
what they should have done is they should have brought the chest shield down further into the suit so that it actually has definition instead of just being a big wide open space. But from what I understand, the villain of the 30th season is a returned Lord Zedd, which is cool as well. Except
what series are they pulling inspiration from on this one? Or is this fully original?
They are fully original suits. Ugh. And fight sequence.
That's probably why they look like crud.
But the Zords are being taken from Q-Ranger.
Oh.
Which makes me extra sad because the suits in Q-Ranger are super good.
Yeah, they were.
Yeah.
Oh, that's dumb. Also, there's a new actress coming in who is the daughter of in-universe former Yellow Ranger Trini.
Yes, because unfortunately, Toy Trang is no longer with us.
Passed away in 99 or 2001.
No, a long time ago.
It's been a good long while.
Car accident.
Yes, in a car accident.
The new suits look like Charlie Kelly's Green Man could show up and hang out with them.
Kinda,
or that one YouTuber pink guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, show me these suits. I want to see how.
Oh, you're not gonna like them. I mean, the art looks okay, but
is there no real images?
No, they're they did like one teaser.
Yeah, I saw like
video.
Oh, what?
Yeah. See what I mean? The chest. I mean, I like that the main the White Ranger has a cape,
yeah,
signifying kind of specialty kind of thing.
Yeah.
But the chest, the protector should be down to almost their navel instead of up around their neck.
They have like fake pecs, fake abs.
Yes.
It looks like the suit from the movie How High.
Yeah, they're not
the
great.
Main superhero dad. That's what it looks like.
Not How High.
How High.
That's Redman and Method
Man. Yeah. Sky High.
Yes.
I had the high in there somewhere.
You did. Like, they should have either had the suit, the shield go down halfway, or they should have had the extra thing on the
side. Don't get me wrong.
Higher.
The color.
It's not great.
The breakup in the color is not terrible.
It's not terrible, but it's not great.
The suit, this yellow and blue suit on the left here.
Yeah.
Looks like like a cross between like Booster Gold.
It's very Booster Gold-esque,
and,
yes.
I don't think he has all of his suit on.
And I don't think he does.
And the gold, one of the Ninja Rangers. The Cowboy Ninja Ranger.
Oh, Star Ranger.
Star Ranger, yeah.
I guess, yeah.
It kind of looks like his outfit.
A little bit. Well, we got to get off the Power Ranger topic.
Yeah.
This has been Power Ranger Minute. It's never a minute.
It's never a minute. With me, it's never a minute. We have time for one more news article.
We got to talk about the Roiland.
We got to talk about the Justin.
Yeah, we
got to
talk. Yeah, talk about the smelly elephant in the room.
Yeah. So Rick and Morty's main voice actor and co-creator of the show, Justin Roiland, has been summarily just kicked out of the entire show.
And everything else.
Just about everything, because there were...
allegations, and he's currently under trial.
Yes.
Or will be under trial.
Will be under trial for sexual harassment?
No.
Or is it...
Felony domestic violence with corporal injury and false imprisonment under use of threats and deceit.
Boy, you pulled that right off the top of your head. Good job, dude.
I've been reading a lot about it.
Yeah, yeah.
It happened in 2020, and the state of California has been investigating it. The victim has remained anonymous, but it was someone that Justin Roiland was dating at the time.
Uh-huh.
It's kind of started this whole thing.
And all those things sound absolutely terrible.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
When it's a felony, you know it's bad, especially with domestic violence.
Uh-huh.
Oh, my goodness. And corporal injury means there was a severe injury.
Oof, gosh.
Either probably a burn or something.
Yikes.
And then false imprisonment through intimidation and deceit. Not a good look.
It's any one of those things would be bad, but putting them all together is like a nightmare scenario.
And then a whole bunch of like Twitter DMs and stuff alleged that Roiland allegedly Scooby-Doo that Roiland allegedly did with minors and
it's a whole thing.
And I think I read somewhere of a possibility of either sexual harassment or I don't think it was sexual misconduct, but something along those lines at Squanch Games too.
Yeah, so he is straight up
stepped in it.
Yeah, he sure has. So that means he's being dismissed from his own video game company, Squanch Games.
Quote unquote resigned, but it was probably more of a hey, you need to go, or we'll make you go.
Right.
That's definitely how that seemed like it went.
Yes, and he's also been let go from Rick and Morty. Adult Swim has completely dropped him.
Yep. Hulu did too.
Oh, so they did for Solar Opposites.
Yeah.
And this is really interesting because he is the voice of both Rick and Morty and a bunch of extra characters and stuff. Yeah,
and also he's Corvo in Solar Opposites,
right,
which is one of the main characters.
I mean, he's co-creator of both shows. Both his shows.
Yeah, so it's going to be fascinating to see.
Also, the fact that Adult Swim said, even though they have severed ties with Justin Roiland, the team is still working on season 7.
Because they have to.
Well, yeah, they're under contract.
They are under contract for a 10-season show.
Yeah, and that's a lot of people's jobs that they don't deserve to lose just because Justin
Roiland
was a stinker.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But also, Dan Harmon was kind of a stinker, too, and he was also co-creator and writer on the show.
Yeah.
But that was a whoopsie that didn't end in a felony.
This is true.
Well,
it was still gross.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm not a big Dan Harmon fanboy or anything.
I'm not either, but...
But this definitely
sounds like... significantly worse.
Oh, yeah. But it's definitely I think it's... Honestly, at the end of the day, I think it's a death roll for Rick and Morty.
I imagine they're going to probably have one more season of Rick and Morty. They're probably going to terminate the contract early.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure Warner Brothers or Turner or whoever owns Adult Swim.
It's going to be HBO. HBO Warner.
Which is owned
Discovery.
By Discovery.
Discovery, yeah.
And yet they won't cut Ezra Miller loose. Come on now.
Because that movie's done. Because they've sunk too much money into it and that movie's done.
I still don't care. It's still horrible.
Oh, I agree, but that's the difference here.
But regardless, at the end of the day, when you look at a lot of the jokes that are in Rick and Morty,
you can kind of see
I'm disappointed, but I'm not surprised.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, like I said earlier, both Rick and Morty and his game High on Life have like this teen girl character that Summer is, why is he so fascinated with this archetype of character?
Oh.
And then it's like, oh, that's why.
Well, they haven't. Yeah. It hasn't said if anything. It's about with. I mean, well, the alleged DMs and stuff. Yeah, but the initial charges is about somebody he's dating. They haven't said if that person was a minor or not.
There hasn't been any official.
And I
kind of
hope.
For...
And I kind of hope there isn't, because I would imagine that the horrible fan base that is Rick and Morty would probably, you know, be foaming
back
at the
him.
Yeah, be foaming at the mouth and going after this poor
person.
Actually,
I haven't seen a lot. I mean, I haven't gone looking for it, but I haven't seen a lot of support for him.
That's true, too.
I have not either.
Maybe everyone's kind of like, it's not a good look.
I've seen a lot of, like, innocent until proven guilty garbage.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's not garbage. That's the way our society works. But
sure,
it doesn't work that way when you're an independent business.
Right.
Who doesn't want to work with somebody who's been...
I tell you, the people that I've heard seen the most of this from are people that dropped off from watching the show...
Like a long time ago?
Season one, and are going, yeah, I kind of get it.
Yeah.
I knew something wasn't right with this. But yeah, we will continue to follow this story as it progresses.
Because it will. It will.
I'm sure it will. And it's going to get much worse before it gets better. But yeah.
He's going to go work with the Daily Wire, whatever it is that Gina Carano went to after she made a boo-boo.
Yeah. Anyway, we have actually hit time, so let's go ahead and wrap things up for the week. You have been listening to Nerd Overload. Thank you very much for tuning in. You can find us each and every day over at nerdoverload.com.
You can find us on Facebook, Twitter, Twitch, Instagram, and Patreon if you want to support the show at Nerd Overload Now.
You can email us at staff@nerdoverload.com.
You can leave a voicemail on the Nerd Overload hotline. Just give us your questions, comments, whatever. The number is 419-561-5556. Give us your best Rick and Morty impressions.
Why not? Sure. If it's good enough, we'll send it on over to HBO. They're probably going to be needing it. You can find all of our back episodes on various podcast apps such as Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Play, and more. Finally, I'd like to thank Parker, super friend extraordinaire, that helps man the Nerd Overload Facebook page, and David Pencil for use of our intro and outro. You can find more of his stuff over at davidpencil.com. So again, thank you all for tuning in, and we will be back next week.
Wubba lubba, oh no!
You're fired.